This is BBC Four. The next programme contains some strong language.
Hello and welcome to a special edition of Screen Wipe from Hollywood. Honestly, I have to do that because the Hollywood sign itself is copyrighted, and for me to allow it to appear on screen would cost us thousands of dollars. I can, however, call the people who own the copyright a bunch of money-grabbing bastards for nothing. That's showbiz. Not so long ago, if someone said the words American television to you, a million bad pictures immediately formed in your mind.
Soft focus soap starring shoulder pads instead of people, whooping inbreds tossing cars over swamps, sitcoms half as funny as breaking your jaw on a doorframe, and shape-shifting festival of idiocy, Manimal.
Today, all that's changed, and it's painfully obvious that most of the American shows that make it onto our screens make British TV look like, well, a load of old toot, quite frankly. American TV has thrown off its shoddy reputation and is now widely regarded as some of the best and occasionally the worst TV in the world. So what can it teach us Brits, if anything? We'll get onto that in a minute, but first, because we're a British show doing a US special, let's kick things off with an absolutely pointless and needless "Ooh, look, we're in America!" type montage, because apparently that's the law. There's a lot of TV in the US, and the setup's quite different to ours. Chances are you've heard of the main networks, but don't know quite which does what in the where now. So here's a handy cut-out-and-keep guide. The oldest network is CBS, which started broadcasting in 1939 and is sometimes known as the Tiffany Network, thanks to its reputation for slightly blue-chip programming. In the past, it spawned classics such as the harrowing Laugh-a-thon MASH and the slightly less harrowing Oil Baron-a-thon Dallas. It currently keeps its oar in with hits like gruesome forensics drama CSI. Then there's NBC, known as the Peacock Network, the people who brought you the wonderful Columbo and the equally wonderful Hill Street Blues, currently enjoying success with a somewhat flashier than ours version of Deal or No Deal, and an assured colloquial take on The Office. ABC's next, owned by Disney and sometimes referred to as the Alphabet Network for reasons beyond the realm of normal human understanding. For years a poor cousin to CBS and NBC, ABC eventually came into its own during the 60s and 70s thanks to a combination of sports and mass appeal froth like Charlie's Angels, as well as high-profile, high-caliber miniseries like the excellent Roots. Often sparky and innovative, it's currently home to the sassy suburban Fest, Desperate Housewives, and the downright unusual Lost. The final member of the Big Four is also the newest, Fox, founded in 1986 by
Fox didn't really start kicking network ass until 1989 with the launch of the hilarious and satirical Simpsons. Today it's home to blockbusters like crypto-fascist masturbatory fantasy 24, the upliftingly world-weary House, and the altogether shiny and happy American Idol. Shiny and new.
These terrestrial networks operate under the unforgiving gaze of the Federal Communications Commission, or FCC, a shadowy government agency best known in recent years for taking a very dim view of anything that might possibly contravene their indecency regulations.
In 1972, Home Box Office, or HBO, became the first premium cable network. Today, it's the home of some of the most admired television in the world, ranging from the brutal yet literate Sopranos to Larry David's foul-mouthed comedy of LA manners, Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Foothead, shit-faced, cocksucker, asshole, son of a bitch!
Cable networks aren't subject to the FCC's decency guidelines, which is why Tony Soprano and Larry David are free to turn the airwaves as blue as they like.
Scum-sucking motherfucking whore!
Here's Lewis Black from The Daily Show, who's got some views on TV censorship all of his own.
Ever since 9/11, there are two things that scare the hell out of the leaders of the United States. First, that there might be a terrorist attack. And second, that possibly a naked body might be exposed on a television screen. This all started back at the Super Bowl when Janet Jackson was performing. But before she came out to do her little dance, there was Justin Timberlake. So there he is doing his little dance with that little hat. And out comes Janet. And Justin sees her, and he goes, "I'm going to touch with my pee-pee." And he starts chasing her around. And she's going, "No, no, no." And he's going, "I'm going to touch with my pee-pee. No, no, no. I'm going to touch with my pee-pee. No, no, no." And then he finally touches her with his pee-pee, and he grabs her. And he accidentally rips her dress. And for an instant, there's a flash of flesh on the screen. Just like that. Well, I woke up the next morning, and my beloved country had completely lost its mind. I turned on the TV. Holy God! Did you see the Super Bowl yesterday? It was absolutely staggering. Janet Jackson's breast exposed to the entire nation. What will we do? Let's take a look. Let's take a look. They showed it over and over and over again. Every channel you went to, it was on the internet. The Goodyear blimp had shots of it. You could go anywhere to see it. And then the leaders came out and said, "Bring us the breast. We must see the breast." And they locked themselves up. And they examined that breast from every angle. They examined that breast for so long that I actually thought Osama bin Laden was hiding in it. And then they came out and said, "We've seen the breast. What will it do to the children?" Nothing. It'll do nothing to the children. I don't know if they remember what it was like to be a child, but let me tell you, when I was a kid, you know what I wanted to see? I wanted to see a titty.
When the BBC ordered me to go out and make an American special, I raided the archives and dug up a couple of old copies of Jonathan King's Entertainment USA. You know what? It's not that bad.
Just a few steps from the downtown business area.
As well as highlighting the shiny side of Americana, he does a bit of social commentary too.
Dilapidated buildings, crumbling shacks, broken and boarded up windows.
Although in retrospect, some of the footage is a little unsettling.
Sweet.
Can you imagine the depressing feeling when for the first time the doors clang shut in front of you? From Alcatraz Prison in San Francisco, that's the end of Entertainment USA this week. We'll see you next week. Okay, you can open the doors now. You can open the doors now.
They say tomato, and we say tomato, if we're taking the piss out of the way the royals speak. Yes, we like to think the Americans are just the same as us, apart from their wonky vowels and extra confidence, which is why we've been trying to flog them our old junk for years.
Marmite sandwiches! Marmite sandwich from England.
The frenzied exporting kicked off in earnest 1,000 years ago, when, still reeling from the excitement of Beatlemania, the Americans took David Frost under their wing.
60s Anglomania also convinced the Americans to give some of our programmes a spin, such as The Avengers, which had been running in Britain for years before being bought by ABC in 1966. As part of the deal, they insisted it be shot on film in colour, which is why it still looks so bloody lovely today.
As the 70s dawned, the Americans were exposed to hallucinogenic British comedy like Monty Python and lovely old highbrow documentaries such as Kenneth Clark's Civilization.
Look at those great works of Western.
British drama also flourished. Shows like revered class-conscious serial Upstairs Downstairs were repackaged as part of Masterpiece Theatre with filmed introductions from Alistair Cook that gave the impression you were about to be served a gourmet meal by a butler tugging his forelock so bloody hard he's bashed his head through the floor.
To this day, flogging your format over here is the secret dream of many British programme makers. But until recently, few shows could expect anything more than cult success in the States without undergoing a territorial makeover first.
For instance, when the Americans wanted some blue-collar grit, they looked to the UK, where lo and behold, there was a massively popular show called Till Death Us Do Part.
The proper one,
I never said that.
You
said,
said he was born in Manchester, so well, he ain't a proper blackie then, is he?
But there was no way on earth you could broadcast the original on American TV. They'd have mistaken it for a transmission from Mars. Instead, they remade it as All in the Family. Lovable racist Alf Garnett became lovable racist Archie Bunker.
Mr. Davis, my daughter Gloria standing over there.
Hello, Gloria.
How are you? How are you?
And her husband Mike.
Hello, Mike.
No!
It was such a barnstorming hit, it wasn't long before US producers groomed another gritty Britcom for mainstream success.
You dirty old man!
Strutty old rag and bone duo Steptoe and Son transformed into Sanford and Son, the equally funny landmark black-led sitcom of the 70s.
I never heard you say thank you.
Okay?
Thank you.
Okay!
Weirdly, the exchange never works in reverse.
Take the Golden Girls, for instance. The original was a smash hit, wrinkly chuckle fest beloved by millions.
I'm all right, I'm fine.
But when we remade it as Brighton Bells, it turned out to be half as funny as accidentally reversing over your own children in a tractor with barbed wire wheels on Christmas Day. Despite this, here's a man who thinks US comedy can learn from the UK, writer-producer Rob Long, author of Conversations with My Agent.
American comedy is sort of dead. I don't know, or not dead, but I like to describe American comedy as living in an assisted living facility somewhere in the desert. You know, it's old, and it may not last, but it's still all there. It could be maybe revived somehow. It's not quite dead. But I suspect that's a case of fear. I actually think that British comedy formats or comedy shows will be imported in the next couple of years in record numbers, because you can go to an executive in the United States and say, you don't have to have any imagination at all. I just want to say it works somewhere else. So we'll try it here. And if it doesn't work here, you won't look stupid, because it does work in Britain. Any successful television comedy in the United States is an accident. It's like an industrial mistake. It shouldn't have happened. The system is set up to destroy it by the time it gets out. So if it somehow a successful hit show slips through, it's because people weren't paying attention at the network or the studio, or they were broke and they couldn't replace it, or something happened that went wrong. I try to describe the system as like an industrial conveyor belt, and you pretend your idea is like a little, you know, fluffy bunny. And it goes on a conveyor belt into a cylinder with these rotating knives, right? And the knives must chop it all up so it all looks the same. And then it goes from there to a giant machine that smashes it to smithereens, right? So, but there's a chance that when the knives are rotating up, that the little bunny can get through the knives right when this little concrete smasher goes up, and it will escape. And that would be a Seinfeld or a Friends or a Cheers or, you know, pick a hit. But the ones that go through the system come out, you know, looking chopped up. And that would be a Joey.
The whole UK-US exchange has gone into reverse in recent years. We used to look down our noses at their populist dramas.
Oh, this is ridiculous. Oh, God, look at this. Knight Rider is just aimed at absolute cretins. I mean, look at that, a talking car. Look at his hair.
Now we look up to them.
Oh, God, I mean, really, The Sopranos is so bloody brilliant. I have just pissed my own balls inside out.
I don't believe any of this shit.
We used to import their tacky game show formats.
If you were to walk out on
formats like the Jolly and Anodyne Family Feud, which we remade as Family Fortunes.
Okay.
Now we're the ones selling tacky game show formats to them. Flip on the TV over here and British entertainment formats are all over it, like a rash that married a virus.
Current excruciating hit America's Got Talent, for instance, comes from evil British genius Simon Cowell and features this big English tit.
You belong on the end of a pier.
So, are there any other UK shows we can flog our Yankee cousins? Well, to find out, we subjected a focus group of average Americans to some British TV they might not have seen yet.
OK, this is a clip from a show called Bullseye.
It's a bullseye! And here's your horse, Dave Spiking!
Sit around all day and still lose weight with this computerized six-function Carl Lewis exercise bike.
Tonight's star prize. One. 20.
Okay, so that was Bullseye.
What did you make to that, anyone?
Is the entire premise of the show based on darts?
Yeah. It's pretty dartish, yeah.
I mean, if it weren't for the host, the show would be like watching paint dry.
Are all the prizes still not that great?
Like, that was that edition aired a few weeks ago.
It's very fun because, you know, darts is something that the family unit can participate in, and there's not a lot of things.
You don't see that many families. Tends to just be big guys with arms like hams.
But the prizes, like that boat, were shockingly wonderful. I mean, for just throwing darts. I mean, I wish I could be a contestant on that show.
Okay, what you're going to see now is a very, very popular daytime quiz show goes out every day. It's called Countdown.
Consonant, please.
Thank you, Jack. C.
And another one, please.
Right, here we go, chaps. Any good, Paul?
No, just six.
Just a six. Jack?
Six.
What's your six, Jack?
Capote.
Capote, mm-hmm. Right.
Very good indeed.
Six apiece, though. Yeah. Kim?
I didn't get anything, I'm afraid.
No. So that was Countdown. Anyone find that exciting?
Horrible.
I like it.
Horrible? Sorry, horrible.
Horrible.
Almost as exciting as Scrabble.
Yes. I think I'm mostly shocked by the cheap production value. I mean, it looks like something that would be here, like, in the early 70s at best. And I'm like, hello, they have computers now that can give you those letters. Like, Vanna just points now. She doesn't actually have to put letters up, you know.
You were offended by the cheap production
values. Not offended, but kind of shocked.
You looked offended.
Well, I'm a little offended. I mean, visually it's somewhat offensive, you know, because it's like, there's a lot better available now, and why aren't you using it?
We know we can't afford it!
Next, we showed them Twitcher-friendly rural voyeur series Springwatch.
Meanwhile, back at the nest box, which appears to be empty because the youngsters are fledged. Look, this is a male.
I hate to tell you, but a moment ago, in fact, while the cuckoo film was on, the badgers were out. But there is no...
I see no badger, as they
sign
say.
Of them now.
No.
What did you make to that, anyone? Oh, sorry, you put your hand up straight up there.
I feel like I was at a friend's place watching a slideshow that was not going to end for several hours.
I don't know. It was very cheesy, I would say.
Does anyone have any ideas on how you would adapt that for the US market?
Drama.
Right. Interest.
Well, maybe this will grab their interest. The Bill, ITV's pulse-quickening cop drama.
Stop. Please, stop. Mate, 1 minute, please. Relocate to the pavement.
Relocate to the pavement now, please.
Just excuse us for 1 minute.
Yeah. Should I do all this?
So now we're supposed to be relationship counsellors in this job too. It really winds me up.
Everything winds you up right now.
No, I'm sorry for being snappy with you earlier. What is it with you and Emma anyway?
Me and Emma? Oh, we're just good friends.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Trust me, I'm a free agent.
Yeah, me too.
Who thought that was any good whatsoever? What were you saying?
I thought it was a comedy just because, like... the super bad acting and the super cheapness and super low quality of everything.
So it's hard to buy into the drama aspect of
it. Yeah,
it
felt like a send-up, you know? I mean, I would want to see more of it. It just felt like it was some sort of almost mockumentary play on, you know, these sort of drama shows. Like, even between the cops is, like, what's their relationship about? You know what I mean? It's like, he's about to lay a kiss on the guy, or what's going on, you know?
Sounds like what they really want is more realism. Well, thank God for that, because it doesn't come more realistic than this, EastEnders.
Any chance of a brew, Dorothy? I'm spitting feathers here, love.
I'm sorry, you'll have to make your own.
What is your problem? Slagging me off over the vic ain't enough for you. You come round to finish the job.
Wait a minute,
I have had enough of you. You're doing my head in.
Listen to me.
You've got nothing to say that I want to hear anymore. I want you out of my life. You're dead to me.
Regular soap action?
Yep.
I like it better than our soaps. Our soaps are, everyone has a shitload of makeup on. She didn't look like she had any makeup on, and everyone looked, once again, quite normal. And I like that. Most soaps are so overdone, and the characters are so gorgeous, it's like they're painted.
The acting is much better in this than our soap operas. Our soap operas, we had this long dramatic pause after every sentence for some reason, which
well, they're remembering
that way in real life. So it seemed much more true to real life, and I actually watch the show. I like it.
It's interesting to me. You know, it doesn't seem to be that vanity about the people on television.
That was a really polite way of saying they were all pig ugly.
America's soaps are markedly different to ours. They're on during the day, they last a full punishing hour, and the standard of every aspect of them makes EastEnders look like I, Claudius. Yes, it's Acorn Antiques all the way, replete with abysmal dialogue.
No chance, fancy face.
Wobbly sets.
God, I knew it. What is wrong with her?
And acting so bad it isn't even wooden, it's bloody cardboard.
Go, please. Wait in the hall, please, and wait till I give you further orders. Go, please.
Yeah, whatever.
Two things immediately strike you. First of all, that American Soapland is so stagey and unnatural, it feels like a dystopian future world overseen by the hunks of Olympus. Secondly, everyone's so good-looking, it's difficult to tell them apart. In fact, a lot of them look like bad celebrity look-alike versions of established stars. Look, here's the poor man's Brad Pitt. Here's the Argos Heather Graham.
You haven't told me that since what, junior high?
And here we see the pound stretcher Meg Ryan romancing it up with a cheapo Kurt Russell. Oh, and this so-called Britney Spears is just taking the piss.
Cannot see where he is.
The soaps are aggressively targeted at frustrated housebound women, so the male members of the cast spend most of their time walking around in a sort of shirtless daze, dangling around on screen like haunches of beef in a display cabinet. Still, it befits their apparent IQ. This one's too dumb to even register pain. Hit him again. While the men bumble around with their tits hanging out, the women specialise in non-stop cattiness.
Look, honey, if you can't keep up with today's technology, don't blame your failures and your mistakes on me. We won't have that.
I'm quaking in my shoes.
Unfortunately, despite the lurid storylines, the truth is that thanks to the constraints of the budget and the amount of time they have to fill, 90% of the action seems to consist of characters standing around in rooms endlessly debating the minutiae of the plot with all the emotion of half-sentient vending machines.
We should have known. We should have trusted our suspicions. It's a brilliant plan. Who would have suspected that Alistair was healthy when his body was lying there unconscious for everyone to see?
Still, in plot-stretching terms, the clear king of the soaps has to be the demented Passions, which plays like the sort of thing you might see in your mind's eye after being hit on the head with a car jack. Passions doesn't throw reality out the window so much as jettison it into the sun. For instance, one of the characters is a mermaid.
Could this beautiful woman be a mermaid? No way.
And that's not me taking a scene out of context. She really is a mermaid.
You're about to find out that you should never make a mermaid angry. And right now, I'm boiling mad. Come and get her, boys! I don't see anybody out here. Ow! Ow!
Then there's arch-villain Alistair, who's a bit like the most evil daytime game show host the world has ever seen.
Because with the power of the chalice, I can now vanquish each and every one of you.
He is my favourite, actually, just because the guy playing him is clearly having a whale of a time making his performance as stupid as humanly possible.
I knew you would fly here to help your lover, especially after your idiot father of yours discovered that Whitney was here.
You let Mr. Crane and my mom know where Whitney disappeared to?
Duh. I am going to destroy everyone who tried to destroy me.
Other characters include Luis, a profoundly dumb hunk, whose entire life seems to consist of him having flashbacks.
Yeah, maybe he was watching us when...
What is it?
That monk. What about him? I don't know, there's something familiar about him. Hey, you! Stop!
In fact, he spends so much time queuing up clips from yesteryear, he's like a one-man bloody clip show.
Morning!
And when he's not doing that, he's thinking aloud in voiceover.
Only she has. Beth took Marty to his grave along with her.
Without post-production, he'd be f***ed. Anyway, you've got to admire Passions just for its sheer balls. Go on, name another soap that'd have the nerve to introduce the Pope as an incidental character.
Oh, bless us, Father.
What has happened here?
And get him doing Arnold Schwarzenegger impersonations.
Calm yourself. You've done no wrong. The deceiver used you as we knew he would.
All in all, American Soapville is a bizarre fantasy land in which nothing makes sense. It's full of sex and death and men walking around with their shirts off talking bollocks. It's just like Dunstable, really, but with a bit less concrete and piss.
If you do come over to the States, I insist you buy one thing, and that's R. Kelly's Trapped in the Closet on DVD, an epic 12-part hip-hopera that, frankly, has to be seen to be believed. Here's episode 9 of 12.
He looks around the kitchen and says something is really weird. Then she says, why do you say that? He says, 'cause you keep trying to get me out of here. He said, ever since I've been in this house, your face has went from white to red. And remember when I first walked through the door, you act like you had seen a ghost from the dead. Then he says, girl, if you're hiding something, I'm gonna be so mad. Then he hears something falling. He says, what the fuck was that? She said, it sounds like it came from upstairs. Sounds like the plumbing. He said, woman, that sound did not come from upstairs. I'd be damned if you're not up to something. Said, now the sound that I just heard, it came from this kitchen. And then he looks over by the stove while she's easing over by the dishes. And then he walks over to the refrigerator and pushes it back. And then he looks over in her face, looks like she's about to have a heart attack. Then he notices the pie on the counter, one slice is missing. Now the story's getting scary, 'cause he comes to realize that Bridget is allergic to cherries. Then he slowly looks up at her, and now her face is red as hell. He's breathing real hard, moving closer, she says, huh, you don't look so well. And then he says, move, she says, no. He says, move, she says, no. Bitch, move, she moves. Looks at the cabinet, he walks to the cabinet, get close to the cabinet, now he's opening the cabinet. Now pause the movie, 'cause what I'm about to say to y'all is so damn twisted. Not only is there a man in his cabinet, but the man is a midget.
You know what? I think there's actually just too much television in America. Here's Lewis Black.
I think, and there's a moneymaker here, that you could put on a network and all that would appear on that network is a bowl of shit. And it'd have to be steaming. Can't just be lying there. It needs to be steaming. Why? Because motion catches the eye. You'd never see a human being. All you'd see is a bowl of shit. And it plays some of that new age music so it's relaxing. And they'd watch it for a second and go, holy shit, that doesn't make sense, and they'd go away. But I guarantee you, it would haunt them. And every day they would turn on the TV, and they'd watch, and they'd watch, and they'd watch, and then they'd go, where was that bowl of shit? And then they'd put it in that recall button. So they'd wake up, watch the morning news, and go, bowl of shit! Eventually, they'd start watching it for longer periods of time to see what was going on. But they'd never see a human being, just a steaming bowl of shit. But here's the kicker. Eventually, we put a number up, and you can call that number. And what you have to do is guess which celebrity gave us the shit. Mm-hmm. That's right. It's a contest. Oh, and it's a buck a call. And we're in charge. So nobody really knows who the winner is, do they?
America is the land of the free and the home of the brave. And thank Christ they're brave, because some of their TV would be enough to make a more cowardly nation crap its collective spine through its great big mutual bumhole.
He lurks in the dark, then strikes out of nowhere.
Yes, if it's scaremongering you're after, here it is, flowing from the box like a river of screams.
While we Brits have a wussy inbuilt aversion to overt sensationalism of real-life events, the Americans have raised it to an art form, a frantic tone poem of twisted metal, gunfire, and all-round...
Take your clothes off!
No!
Take your clothes off!
No!
Perhaps the most successful real-life horror show is America's Most Wanted, the long-running equivalent to Crime Watch and one of the first shows to put Fox on the map. To station execs, these shows are a gift. They cost around a tenth as much as the average primetime show, and the gaudy content ensures the audience can't bear to look away, probably in case one of these guys is standing behind them.
The police see every side of human nature.
The crown prince of reality crime shows has to be this man, Sheriff John Bunnell, host of World's Wildest Police Chases and the source of the most feverishly lurid vocal style in history.
This is your first-class ticket to high-speed action, and you're in the driver's seat.
He's running on the rim only at this time.
Cable station Court TV plays host to most of this high-octane shit. Shows like Hot Pursuit, which looked like a live-action version of Grand Theft Auto.
Just got into that van. It looks like he's carjacking another vehicle here.
And sound like they're scripted by Dr. F***ing Zeus.
The baddie in the caddy led the officers on a wild chase, but paid the price getting maced in the face.
Still, gut-wrenching though they may be, since 9/11, all these shootouts and car chases feel like quaint slapstick compared to the dread spectre of terrorism.
Perhaps the most startling example is the Showtime miniseries Sleeper Cellar, jarring, torn from today's headlines, tale of terrorists at large, which played like a cross between an intelligent Robert Fisk article and a very bad episode of The A-Team. But it's not just drama that's frightening.
US advertisers are unashamedly eager to set you shivering so much you shake all the coins out of your own pockets.
Bill is a formidable man, but he was no match for something smaller than a bead of sweat. It KO'd him so fast he didn't even see it coming. It was a clot. Ask your doctor about Plavix today, because no matter how formidable you are, you're no match for a dangerous clot.
And if that's not enough, the breakneck list of potential side effects should have you reaching for the heart pills in no time.
People taking MAOIs or thyroidazine or who have uncontrolled glaucoma should not take Cymbalta. Tell your doctor if your depression worsens or you have thoughts of suicide.
With all this panic juice sloshing around the screens, you'd expect the Americans to be permanently jumpy and neurotic. But weirdly, the exact opposite seems to be true. Yes, it's a cliche, but it's true. One of the first things you notice about Americans is how laid back and friendly they are. All right, you big American fucker.
Here I am.
Check this lot out, for example. Yes, even on doomy, jackbooted Fox News, the presenters chum it up like nobody's business.
Just a little bit tiki, come on, please.
And that's when the terror alert's elevated. When it's neutral, they sit around in their pants playing kaplunk. When our newsreaders try to relax, they just look awkward, like they've accidentally shat themselves and don't want to let on.
So how do they do it? Leaping from unbridled fear one minute to unbuttoned how's-it-hanging-ness the next. How do the Americans retain their sanity? I don't f***ing know. Go and ask a sociologist. Go on, go and phone one up.
British TV may be drowning in F-words and innuendo, but surely that's preferable to the shameless ghoulishness of much of American television. Take this delightful slice of primetime fare, NBC's To Catch a Predator.
They drive up to our door, then they're dragged into court. Can online predators be taken off the streets? Tonight in To Catch a Predator.
Yes, it's a hidden camera investigation with delicious overtones of entrapment, in which a bunch of crusaders from an outfit with the apparently unironic title Perverted Justice pose as underage teens in internet chat rooms. They make contact with sweaty-palmed men.
I cannot believe that I'm actually thinking about blanking your blank.
Then they reel them into a house filled with cameras and the news media's answer to Jeremy Beadle.
But instead of being greeted by a child, he meets me.
Did you have a hard time finding the place?
Not at all. How are you today?
Good, how are you?
I'm doing good. What can I do for you?
Like most of the men who come in the door, this man agrees to talk. He may think I'm a cop. At first, I don't tell him who I am.
Most of the fun, and okay, it's a news program, but come on, it's definitely entertainment. Most of the fun comes from watching the men's bewildered expressions the moment Captain Righteous steps into the room.
That's nothing compared with what happens when he starts reading the transcripts of their web conversations out loud and the feeble excuses start flying.
You ask her if she's horny.
What's wrong with that?
You ask if she does anal.
It's a question.
I was actually just going to stop by here to let her know that I wasn't going to be here because I have to go meet with other people.
Wait a minute. You came by here to tell her that you weren't going to come here.
Thing is, there's a definite air of leering curiosity going on here. The host's like a morally outraged Victorian gentleman who's a bit too interested in uncovering the precise level of depravity involved.
Have you ever asked somebody to blank you off? You talk about...
Oh, I won't deny that there was
You sexual... talk about penis size here.
I mean, those are normal chat things on...
It's normal chat things with a 14-year-old boy? Ask him if he's horny. And then say, I wish you were not so far away. What conclusion can I draw from this?
Yeah, what conclusion?
And despite the subject matter, I have little doubt that the whole thing's being surreptitiously played for laughs. In fact, you half expect to see them popping up in a little inset box in the corner, laughing about it all with the host in the studio afterwards.
I gotta finish getting changed, okay?
Huh?
Actually, he is quite funny because he looks like a little Fonz.
It takes him a second to get on the stool because he's under 5 feet tall.
You say, then I'm big. She says, really? Yeah, how? Then you give the dimension of your penis.
Oh, did I really say that?
Sometimes they might as well whack on a laugh track and some comedy sound effects and have done with it.
Did you bring anything with you tonight?
Such as?
Condoms.
Yes, I did.
How were you going to use the condoms in the
conversation? I wasn't going to use them at all.
You got them in your pocket.
Well, yeah, I do.
You have do them. Balloon tricks with them? Or?
No.
I want to be on the news, dog.
Well, it's a little late for that, dog. Now, if there's anything else you want to tell me...
He quickly comes up with a disguise.
Sometimes just watching them turn up isn't funny enough, so the program really f**ks with them, encouraging this guy to strip off before entering the house in a sick version of Trigger Happy.
You want to explain yourself? What?
Right, if you're going to play this for chuckles, you might as well go the whole hog, yeah? Have the presenter walk out dressed as an 8-year-old girl. Now that would be funny.
The potential predators aren't just there as stooges for a hidden camera fun fest. This is justice in action, so the moment they step outside, Chewbacca attacks them.
Police on the ground!
Yes, the police are cooperating with the show every step of the way. In fact, they even make it legally possible for the show to work at all.
Get on the ground!
In Ohio, in order for prosecutors to file the most serious charges, a police officer needs to be involved in the online chat or phone conversation. Since in this case, perverted justice members are the decoys, the sheriff's department temporarily deputized the PJ volunteers who were in our house.
Next week, perverted justice are granted temporary hangman's rights, and the fun really begins.
Even when the men are tossed in the back of the cop car, the laughs keep coming, because the cameras are still on hand to record every sorry detail of what happens next.
When the detective takes off the handcuffs so the man can sign his statement, he grabs the pen and makes a half-hearted attempt to stab himself.
Put his hand behind your back.
You better behave, right?
Was it a threat?
It's hard to imagine a show like this being broadcast in the UK at all. Okay, an extreme edition of Tonight with Trevor McDonald might get close, but not really. But the truly shocking thing about To Catch a Predator is this. That went out at 8 p.m. on a Sunday evening.
It seems hardcore crime shows like To Catch a Predator or The Violently Disturbing Cops are par for the course in America. So what will the focus group make of our approach to real-life crime in shows like the ludicrously mundane Rail Cops?
Excuse me. The conductor guard is just asking to have you removed from the train, right? What you've just done, you've just been prizing the doors open, right, and that could cause damage to the train. He won't now want you off it. And I could now, if I really, really wanted to, have you removed from this station.
The fan leaves with a reprimand and has to catch a later train.
You watch Cops? Because they show stuff that you wouldn't normally see on the Metro. That's the kind of stuff you'd see on a daily basis riding the Metro.
So it's a bit mundane.
How would that differ from the portrayal of the police you'd see on TV over
here? Our cops are hardcore. Yeah. They, like, wrestle people to the ground, and there's shootings and, you know, crazy people running on LSD and stuff. So that was really boring as far as a cop show, like a reality cop show. Ours are much more excited.
I have actually got another bit of real cop action, but it's possibly even more mundane than that.
Is that an assault? Is your wife a kebab stand hand on you?
Now she caught me with a nail then.
In the car as we were driving past. I think it was a case of grabbing in a you know, messing about way.
That was just a little bit more action. That's about as active as they get.
Okay,
yeah, sorry.
This was more like being punked to me. Like, is that real? They're still doing that for the camera. I don't think he would be that calm on a regular day.
Well, he was...
Should be assault.
In L.A.
Sorry, you.
They'd shoot you if you grabbed a cop in the face like that.
Stiff upper lip.
Like,
yes.
The police weren't even that excited.
Well, they can't. They haven't got guns they could reach for and stuff, you see.
They don't have guns?
There's no guns.
No.
No.
Right, I forgot about it. Whoa. You have serial killers, though, right?
We've had some pretty impressive serial killers.
It seems there's a greater sense of satire. Even with the Rail Cop show, I was just trying to think when I've watched our version of Cops, I don't think you ever see a police officer being depicted in a bad way. Do you know what I mean? It's never sent up. It's always... people are bad, and this is what cops gotta do. You know, you don't, and in this, you got the real cop being kind of a prick, you know?
Now, a short while ago on this program, I described HBO's Deadwood as being one of the best shows of the last 5 years, and I was right, it is. But it isn't the best, because the best show of the last 5 years, possibly even the last 10 years or 20 years come to that, is another HBO show, not as well known, called The Wire. The Wire is quite simply a stunning piece of work. Dip into it for 5 minutes and you could be forgiven for thinking it's just another cop show, but you'd be so wrong you might as well hurl yourself into a great big bloody bin.
That's him there in the orange.
At its core, it's a drama dealing with the ongoing war of attrition between cops and drug dealers on the streets of contemporary Baltimore. Ever heard on a
wiretap. But it's more than that. It's not a simple goodies versus baddies melodrama. It's, and it actually physically pains me to use this phrase because anyone who uses it sounds like an absolute tosser. But it is truly multi-layered.
Every character in the programme is trapped somehow, be it within the bureaucratic confines of the police department.
So what can I tell you? If this case doesn't fall, we're all going to be stepping on our dicks trying to explain what happened.
Or the unforgiving brutality of the street.
You think you fucked up now?
What's up?
Look what they did to my ride!
I'll do it or don't, but I got some place to be.
Police and the drug gangs are presented as two distinct networks, each with their own power structure, internal political wranglings.
Do the chair know we gonna look like some punk-ass bitches out there?
Motherfucker, I will punk your ass.
Yo,
shit.
Frank.
What?
And enforced compromises for everyone involved.
I understand. If I have to throw Burrell a scapegoat or two, I got what to throw.
Both of them are regularly shat on by the only truly powerful forces in the programme, which lurk somewhere at the top and are only concerned with lining their own pockets or covering their asses.
It's a serial that unfolds slowly and dramatically like a novel, which isn't surprising because that was actually its creator's intention.
Speaking of creators, the show was created by a former police reporter, David Simon, working in conjunction with a former homicide detective. And as you might imagine, this gives it an air of authenticity that's largely unmatched in TV drama.
It's also an angry and intelligent show that offers no easy solution to the problems that it focuses on.
For instance, in season 3, a police chief, frustrated by the never-ending cycle of violence, introduces a highly unofficial safe zone for drug use in a bid to shift dealers from the corners, a move he likens to the concession allowing public drinking from brown bags. Not that the show presents drug use as being without consequence, in fact, quite the reverse.
Are you sure this guy wants to be selling you weight?
The characterisation across the whole series is absolutely rock solid, which, given the huge number of characters involved, is an amazing achievement.
Performances, too, are almost uniformly brilliant. Picking out a couple of the cast for special praise feels almost unfair. But you know what? I am unfair, so I'm going to do it anyway.
Snitching bugs.
Particularly worthy of note are Michael K. Williams playing idiosyncratic bandit Omar, Andre Royo as shambolic crackhead Bubbles, and Brixton's very own Idris Elba as brooding, charismatic drug lord Stringer Bell.
I ain't going to hold out.
All right, man, double the muscle on every stash we got. And if the man coming, make ready for the man.
Bloody good accent there as well. He's not the only Brit in the cast, incidentally.
Dominic West plays lead cop Jimmy McNulty with a slightly less convincing accent, but what the hell, this show's so good it could literally fart in my face and I'd still love it.
You can get the first 2 seasons of The Wire on DVD, and season 3 has just been released in the US. Season 4, meanwhile, should be airing later this year on FX here in the UK. If you like good drama, you have absolutely no excuse for not indulging in this. It is just f***ing brilliant.
I'd like to tell you a true story about American television, and I know it's true because it happened to me. CBS had called me and wanted to fly me out to audition for a pilot for a sitcom. I'd been seen in New York City by a writer, a director, and a producer, and they'd watched my stand-up act. And from that act, they took a whole bunch of lines of mine and created a character for this pilot. I was flying out to Los Angeles to audition for a part which was me. Let me make that clear. I was going to Los Angeles to audition to be myself. LSD is the only thing that could prepare you for the point where you'd be auditioning to be you. And let me tell you this, I gave a great audition. Why? Because I'm me. An hour after the audition, I got a call from CBS and they said, yes, you gave a great audition. However, there was someone who gave a better one. Unbeknownst to me, there was a better me out there. I'm just glad that show isn't on the air. Oh boy. Because I couldn't be me anymore.
In Britain, we tend to look down on fantasy and escapism. We associate quality television with kitchen sink realism.
Oh, look, everyone. Look how the paupers live. Oh, goodness, isn't it frightful? Tune in next week and see how much worse their lives have become.
Either that or flouncy costume drama.
Oh, gadzooks, my good fellows. Archibald's dropped his hanky in Tossington Hall.
American TV doesn't suffer from this, or at least not to the same extent. Their TV writers tend to be drawn towards weirdness, not worthiness.
Picture a 50s sitcom, for instance, and you probably think of something as cosy and toothless as this. Leave It to Beaver.
Bye, Mom, I love you! And I'll be in my room later!
But why? That never aired in Britain, you idiot. In reality, vintage US sitcoms were just as likely to star a talking horse.
I'm Mr. Rare.
Or a witch. Or a genie who looked like she was going to drop to her knees and blow Larry Hagman the minute the camera stopped turning.
For off-the-wall Freudian symbolism, how about My Mother the Car, in which Jerry Van Dyke's mother is reincarnated as a motor vehicle.
Mom, you look just beautiful.
And I feel just beautiful, Davy.
Thing is, it just makes him look like a madman.
Barb, Randy, Cindy, I want you all to brace yourselves. This car right here did talk to me and plead and beg me to take her home. And I say her because this car is my mother.
Look, he's literally inside his mum. And now he's coming out. Now he's going back in. Oh, God, I don't even want to think about what he's doing here.
For my money, the king of TV oddity hails from the 1950s.
Yes, The Twilight Zone, Rod Serling's classic Twist in the Tale serial, which used sci-fi as a kind of cloaking device to sneak a starkly anti-nuclear message onto Cold War screens.
Henry Bemis, now just a part of a smashed landscape. Just a piece of the rubble. Just a fragment of what man has deeded to himself. Mr. Henry Bemis in the Twilight Zone.
Chilling stuff, although sometimes the message was nothing more profound than, if you've got a plane, for God's sake, don't let William Shatner on board.
There's a man out there.
What?
Look, he's crawling on...
Incidentally, there's an acting masterclass from Shatner here. Watch this sequence and bear in mind all he has to do is get the policeman's gun without being noticed.
You'll find further outright lunacy in that great American institution, the novelty crime fighter series.
Live-action cartoons like the campy Batman made about as much sense as a polythene sandwich, but were fun, fun, fun all the way. They later evolved into man-made marvels like the absurd Knight Rider or this f***er Automan. Oh, come on, he's a hologram, as if. This is just nonsense.
In fact, on a scale of 1 to 10, think of me as an 11.
Well, yes, it is nonsense, and it flopped, as did Manimal. The point is, at least they tried Manimal. No one said, hey, can we make a hospital drama instead? No. They said, you mean the guy turns into a snake? That's fucking awesome! They dared to dream. And perhaps, if we embrace some of that wide-eyed escapism, we'd have fewer Holby cities ourselves, and more things that were actually worth watching or exporting. It's just a thought.
Well, there you go. That's the end of the American edition of Screen Wipe. We'll be back next week with an exclusive 3-hour look at Belgian television. Be there.
Next tonight, Ben Anderson holidays in the danger zones of El Salvador, Honduras and Panama to find out what life's like now the Americans have moved out. Stay with us.